and glad we serve a big God. Amen. Number 42 in your hymnal, 42, saved by the blood of the crucified one. Let's all stand together as we sing. Number 42, glory, I'm saved. Amen. On that first together.
Saved by the blood of the crucified one. Now ransomed from sin and a new work begun. Sing praise to the Father.
Good to see you in church on Sunday night, and good morning this morning, and looking forward to what the Lord has for us tonight. Appreciate you being here on Sunday evening. Let's open in prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before you tonight, and we thank you, Lord, for another Sunday evening to be together in the house of the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your blessing this morning and for decisions that were made for you and for the visitors that you brought our way. And Father, we bow here at the beginning of this service and ask you to meet with us again tonight. Lord, you know the needs of our heart. You know them better than we do. And I pray, Lord, that you'd meet the needs of each individual that's here tonight, that Christ will be exalted, and that you'll be pleased with what goes on in this place. Bless the music and our fellowship together. Bless and honor the preaching of your word tonight. It's in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
355, wonderful grace of Jesus, 355, let's sing that verse together.
Wonderful grace of Jesus, greater than all my sin. How shall my tongue describe it? Where shall its praise begin? Taking away my burden, setting my spirit free. Rolling sea,
Great singing tonight. Now, a couple announcements for us. Remember, pay attention now. Thank you, by the way, to all of you who helped so much with the funeral dinner, the memorial service for Marion Skinner, and many, many folks working and pulled that off. There was a full house here yesterday, and you just did a wonderful job from setup to cleanup. Everything was just wonderful and great, great testimony for the Lord. Thank you for helping. Remember, if you haven't got any cards yet, there's just a handful left back there. I sure would like to clean all those up, and if you, Lord hasn't laid on your heart anything, just take a look and see if there's something you might be able to do back there to finish the cards out. Do your best to return the gift and the card for the missionaries by next Sunday evening, all right, September the 4th, and that'll be great. If there's other arrangements, you can't get in till later on Wednesday night or on the 11th, you make sure you see the ladies, and they'll make a note of that for you. Okay. Tomorrow night, ladies, will be your night out, remember, and you'll be going bowling, all right? That's sign up downstairs right on the sheet there, so we need to call them and let them know exactly how many ladies to expect tomorrow evening. You'll have a great time. 6:15 right here, and then you go down to the bowling alley from here. And then Tuesday night at 7 will be Grove City School of the Bible. And those of you who signed up for that, remember to be here in your place on Tuesday evening for that at 7 o'clock. That's in the Fellowship Hall. And then Wednesday night, we'll have our midweek service, of course, right here at 7. And we have a family coming who've been missionaries in China. And I think you'll really be interested in their ministry and what the Lord has done and is going to do with them. And so you'll look forward to meeting the Fry family on Wednesday evening. All right. Then we're, of course, preparing for the missions conference. Now, we need some help during the missions conference, which Thursday, Friday, not on, just Thursday and Friday, really. Saturday evening we have the service, but it's just the meal and then a service in here with one preacher. On the other nights, we have a missionary who will have the first part of the service. We'll sing a song, turn it over to him. He'll show usually a video of some kind and then talk about his field or preach a message to us. We usually give him a good 30 to 40 minutes. So the first part of the service is about 45 minutes, and we have two ladies helping our nursery during that time. Then they come out for the second half, and two others go in. So nobody misses everything in a night. You always get half of the service, okay? But that puts a lot of weight on a few ladies that help in the nursery. And if we could have some ladies who don't ordinarily work in the nursery say, hey, I'll work half of those, one of those services. It's a 45-minute, 45 minutes, never more than an hour time in the nursery. You'll never have any better than that. And if you could help out and you're willing to do that, would you put your hand up and just say, I'll do that during the missions conference for part of a night, okay? Jacqueline, you're already in. We got you down, all right, Amy? All right. Is there anybody else could do that? Felicia, you're already in. We got you down. I need looking for ladies who aren't normally in the nursery, and you might be willing to do that. Anybody else? We need your help. All right. Thank you. When it comes to a month like this, and you have the extra missions conference, then October comes, and there's five Sundays. It gets to be a lot on a few. And the more we have, the better off it is on everyone. All right? Great. Okay. And let's see. Okay. For the missions conference, we have dinner for our missionaries on Thursday and on Friday. And again, on Sunday after church, we serve a meal for them. And we're in need of six pies, any kind of pies. And three 9x13 fruit cobblers, okay? And any volunteers to help with some of those pies? Rachel, you want to do a cobbler? Okay. What kind of cobbler? You'll do a peach cobbler? Okay. And you're going to do a pie? A pumpkin pie. Okay, who's behind me? Kind of pie are you making, Xavier? Wow, he threw his voice all the way out here. Isn't that amazing? Incredible how he did that. Ventriloquism on top of all his other gifts, huh? And Nikki, the cobbler. Okay. Very good. Tanya will do two pies. You'll do a pie, Jeanette? Okay. Do you know what kind you're going to make? Surprise pie. Tanya? Good. Cream pie. As long as it's chocolate, we're in business, Jeanette, okay? No pressure. Yeah. Any kind of cream pie you want, just so it's chocolate, okay? We'll be all right. All right, 2, 3, 4, 5. I got 5 pies. I have 1 more pie. Anybody else 1 pie? Brother Moreland? Whoa. Now, I happen to know his wife's in Uganda, all right? So, and send it up? Yeah, okay. Anybody else want to make a pie? All right, that's great. Thank you. Wonderful. All right. Okay, I think that's all I've got. And what about your float? You doing anything tonight? Or? Is it on here? Where's the note? Over here. Oh, okay. What's it say? Okay. All right. Those of you who signed up to help with the float during the missions conference. That is Saturday of the missions conference is the Arts in the Alley parade in Grove City, and we're putting a float in it this year. I mean, it's a float. I mean, you got the balloons and the whole 9 yards. It's really going to look sharp. All right. So you want to help with that. Meet with Brother Bob Reed after service. Go to the conference room. Sure. Go to the conference room, and he'll get you squared away and let you know what's going to be need to be done with that. And the preparation and getting it ready, it'll be here before we know it. In fact, it's 3 weeks from yesterday, and so it's coming up fast, and so we want to be prepared for that and have that ready. We got the John and Romans ready, 6,000 of them, and and one thing we did last year was we gave away candy along the route, and we'd like to do that again this year. Any kind of candy, if you would just bring in some candy, that'd be great. Anything that's probably not chocolate. Okay, if it's this temperature, chocolate's going to be a mess. Now, Tootsie Rolls will pass, okay? That'll be okay. They don't melt. And I know M&Ms don't melt in your hand, but they melt, believe me, okay? When it's 89, they'll melt. So, but any kind of other kind of candy and such, we throw out. We'll gather all we can from what you, if you'll bring it in, then we can put that aside and we'll have a lot of candy to pass out along with our John and Romans, okay? Thank you for doing that. All right. Okay. All right. If you bring that in, and Mrs. Taylor will take care of that at the back table or whatever ladies are there handling that. All right. Well, anybody here tonight for the first time? Looking to see. I don't think we have any first timers here. All right. Let's hear from the choir then. All right.
Jesus.
488, if you would. 488. I was once a sinner, but I came pardon to receive from my Lord. 488, a new name and glory. I was once a sinner, but I came pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that he always kept his word. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven. Let's go back to 56, if you would. Number 56. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. Let's all stand together, if you would. All standing as we sing the old rugged cross. On that first together. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old greet one another, make somebody feel welcome. We'll come back and sing the last stanza together. Thank you. In the old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Let's sing that last together. When we get to the chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out, and we'll sing that a cappella. On that last together, to the old rugged cross, I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory
seated. Ushers will come and get our offering now tonight and give as the Lord has blessed and prospered you. And I'll have Brother McKeon pray for our offering this evening. Brother Bill.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity we have to come and worship you and to honor you. And Lord, we just love you. Bless the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name, amen.
Take your Bible this evening, if you would, to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 6, please. Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians 6, we're going to read verses 10 through 16. Verses 10 through 16. And we'll read them responsively, begin together on 10, then I'll read 11. We'll alternate like that till we end together on verse 16. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 10 of Ephesians chapter 6. Ready? Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of our scripture here tonight. Thank you, Lord, again for the wonderful music this evening. It's been a blessing to listen to, and I pray it's been a blessing for you to listen to as well. And Lord, thank you for the wonderful songs that we have to sing, the songs of God, the songs of Zion. And Lord, I pray that they've been a blessing to others tonight as they have been to my heart. And Lord, we ask you now that you'll make our hearts ready to receive your word. I pray you'll bless the special to that end. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
I was drifting away on life's pitiless sea, and the angry waves threatened my ruin to be. When away at my side, there I dimly descried a stately old vessel, and loudly I cried, "Ship ahoy, ship ahoy!" And loudly I cried, "Ship ahoy!" 'Twas the old ship of Zion, the sailing along. All aboard her seemed joyous, I heard their sweet song. And the captain's kind ear, ever ready to hear, caught my wail of distress as I cried out in fear. Ship ahoy, ship ahoy, as I cried out in fear. The good captain commanded a boat to be lowered, and with tender compassion he took me on board. And I'm happy today, all my sins are washed away in the blood of my Savior, and now I can say, bless the Lord. All I can say, bless the Lord. Oh, soul sinking down, neath sin's merciless wave, the strong arm of our captain is mighty to save. Then trust him today, no longer delay. Board that old ship of Zion and shout on your way. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shout and sing on your way. Jesus saves.
Father, we bow before you in prayer now. We thank you, Lord, for the wonderful truth that Jesus saves. And Father, I'm asking you now for your help this evening as we come to the preaching of the Word of God. Lord, I pray that you'll open our understanding tonight as we look into your Word once again. I ask for your help as I bring this message this evening, and please help the folks as they listen. Lord, I pray that you'll meet with us. Please walk up and down these aisles and go in and out of these rows and stop at every occupied seat and minister to the one there. Lord, give us each a challenge tonight from your Word as we look at this passage in Ephesians chapter 6. And I pray and ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Ephesians chapter 6, if your Bible's still open there, I want you to look in Ephesians. And Ephesians is a wonderful book. The first three chapters of Ephesians are largely just doctrinal. By that, it tells a lot of what we have in spiritual blessings. In fact, Ephesians chapter 1, it says in verse number 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus." If you want to know what all your spiritual blessings are in Christ Jesus, you can find them in the first few chapters of Ephesians 1, 2, and 3. Just read carefully through there, and it's a great Bible study just to underline or circle all the spiritual blessings we have in Jesus Christ. And that goes through the first three chapters, great doctrinal chapters. When you get into chapter 4, you begin to apply those spiritual blessings. You begin to see how we live those out in our life. Notice verse 1 of chapter 4 says, "I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called." And he begins to talk about a walk. He talks about spiritual gifts in chapter 4. He talks about growing up and maturing in your Christian life and not being children anymore, and but maturing in the faith. And then, of course, he gets into putting off the old man, putting on the new man, and putting off the old deeds and putting on the new deeds. And then he gets into chapter 5 and continues our walk and be followers of God as dear children and to walk in love. And later on he tells us to walk circumspectly, and he tells us to walk as children of light. And then he talks about the importance of being filled with the Spirit in order to do that. And he lets us know there's relationships that come into play in our Christian life. And the most important one is the marriage relationship between the husband and the wife. And he deals with that in Ephesians 5. And then you get into chapter 6, and he deals with the relationship between children and their parents. And then he talks about employees and employers, servants and masters, if you will, and talks about that relationship. And then he gets to verse 10 of chapter 6, and he says, finally. Now, that doesn't mean he's done, like most preachers when they say finally, all right? It doesn't mean he's finished, but he's getting down to something here. And he tells them, "Be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil." Who's the devil? Well, he says, "We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." Saying we're going to have an enemy to fight, and there's a battle. There's a spiritual warfare that goes on. It's not just, listen, there's a battle that goes on with the old nature and the old flesh, but there's also spiritual forces at work that battle against the believer. But God says, "I'm not leaving you alone here. I'm not leaving you without armor. I'm equipping you to do battle against Satan." And he lists the armor of God that here in Ephesians chapter 6. You know, it's interesting. You don't hear much about spiritual warfare in these days. In fact, I read recently, I don't know how accurate it is, but into my mind it may be true. They said that there's not been a song written after 1900 that really deals with spiritual warfare. Yet we sing "Onward, Christian Soldiers." That was written quite a few years ago. "The fight is on, O Christian Soldiers. Sound the battle cry, see the foe is nigh. Hold the fort, for I am coming, Jesus whispers still." We don't have any songs like that anymore. I remember as a boy listening to and even in the teenage in my college years, hearing Lester Roloff sing, Run if you want to, run if you will, but I came here to stay. If I fall down, I'm going to get right up. I didn't start out to play. It's a battlefield, brother, not a recreation room. It's a fight and not a game. So run if you want to, run if you will, but I came here to stay. It's a battlefield, brother, not a recreation room. And it's funny, when I thought of that, I thought so much of sometimes churches I've seen that have nice easy chairs sitting around. It's like a recreation room more than a church house, amen? But I tell you what, it's spiritual warfare. And so God doesn't send us, he equips us with the armor we need. The Bible says here, our loins are girt about with truth. It talks about we have the breastplate of righteousness. We have the shield of faith. We have the helmet of salvation. But tonight, I want to focus for our consideration and for our study, verse number 15, where God says, your feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Your feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Four words I want to focus on in that verse this evening, all right? Word number one, excuse me, word number one is feet. Feet, your feet shod. When you speak of the gospel of Christ, we usually think of the mouth first. But God mentions the feet first. And it's interesting. We can still use that kind of in an expression. If you're prompted to speak to somebody and you feel the real urge of the Spirit, you should speak to someone, but you don't, and you kind of chicken out, you say, well, I was going to talk to him, but I got cold feet. We even use that expression. Or we get tangled up in our words, and we maybe don't use the right words, or we say something we don't think we should have said, and we said, man, I really put my foot in my mouth. It's interesting how we link the two together. And well, God did that a long time ago. He said the most important aspect of the gospel begins with the feet. Your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Hold your finger there, put a piece of paper in there in Ephesians 6, and look at Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. Will you look there, please? Romans chapter 10. When you're there, you can say amen. Okay? Romans 10. We know that most of us are familiar with verse 13. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Verse 14 says, then how shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him and of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And by the way, that's the theme of our conference is how shall they hear? How shall they hear? But notice it says, how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. You see, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel. God didn't say your words are beautiful. God said your feet are beautiful when you go and preach the gospel to those who need to hear. The first two letters of gospel is G-O, go. We go with the gospel. Jesus said in Matthew 28, verse 18, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Go ye therefore. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. Psalm 126, 5 and 6. He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. In the parable of the great supper in Luke 14, Jesus, or the master of the house, told his servant, go out quickly into the highways and hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. Go, go, go. Jesus said, the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. What did he say? The solution was, pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. So we're praying for God to send forth, to thrust out laborers into harvest. We're praying for God that people would just go. Go with the gospel. Go and tell people how to be saved. And I would continue tonight, God is sending, but are we going? God is sending, but are we going? He never, ever told the lost they're supposed to come to church and hear about Jesus. I'm glad if they do. I'm thankful if they do come and hear about Jesus. But they were never told they had to do that. But there's without a doubt, over and over and over again, we have the command to go and tell a lost world about Jesus Christ. It starts with your feet. When's the last time your feet took you to give the gospel to somebody? Your feet took you to tell someone else how they could know Jesus as their Savior. Feet. It starts with our feet. The second word I want you to notice in Ephesians 6 is the word preparation. Preparation. Notice it says your feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Did you notice your feet are not shod with the gospel of peace? They're shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. I'm not only willing to go, but I ought to be prepared to go. There ought to be preparation involved. Now, I want to say, just before I get into that, I do want to say, not being fully prepared or not being fully taught is no reason not to go. In John chapter 1, Philip, I believe, becomes a follower of Jesus. He'd been a follower of John, and just as Andrew was a follower of Jesus, and he got burdened for his brother Peter, and he went to Peter and said, I found the Christ, I found the Messiah, come and see. Well, Philip went and found his brother Nathanael. He told Nathanael, he said, we found the Messiah, we found the one who Moses and the prophets spoke about, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Now, wait a minute. Jesus isn't the son of Joseph. He's the son of God. But does that mean Philip didn't get saved? No, guess what? He came to Jesus anyway. You see, don't think, well, I'm afraid I'll make a mistake. You know what? God is able to overlook your mistakes. In your zeal and your newness. We had a fella, I told you about him before. Young fella, I think he was 19 at the time. He was at a college in Arizona State University, Patrick Martinez. Patrick was a fireball. And he showed up at our church. He's a fellow who showed up on Sunday, and in those days we had soul winning on Thursday nights. And Thursday night I had his card, and I was going to go visit him. The only problem was he showed up for soul winning on Thursday night, ready to visit. He didn't know what it was. He just saw it was on the church calendar, so he showed up. And so he was there, and he came for a couple weeks and went out visiting with us, and he felt like he was ready to go, you know. And so he came back one night, and he was excited. Man, I said, man, Patrick, tell us what happened. He goes, oh, man, had two people saved. I said, boy, that's great. Tell us about it. What happened? And he said, man, he said, they were eager. I asked if they knew if they died to go to heaven. They didn't know. And I said, I want to show them from the Bible. And, you know, he said, I just told them in the Bible there how Nebuchadnezzar came to Jesus at night and asked one of Jesus to say, Jesus said you had to be born again. And I showed him how to be born again. And they both got saved. And you think, by the way, in case you aren't sure, that was Nicodemus, not Nebuchadnezzar. Huh? But guess what? You think that person didn't get saved because it was Nebuchadnezzar instead of Nicodemus? No, they got saved. So don't think that well, just because I might mess something up, you know, God's greater than that. And he's able to work your way through that. But let me do say this. I think there is preparation. I think you ought to be able to. How prepared are you to tell someone else how they can know Jesus Christ as their Savior? How prepared are you if someone just walked up you tomorrow and said, hey, what must I do to be saved? Are you ready to lead them to Christ? You should be. You should be able to know how to take your Bible and lead someone to Christ. You know, it's the great commission. It's the great commandment that we go and preach the gospel to every creature. Isn't that something we should prepare for? Isn't that something we should practice? Isn't that something that we should memorize? Isn't that something we should pray for? To be able to be ready to win other people to faith in Jesus Christ? Are you preparing to be effective in giving the gospel to other people? You know, there are some people, and I hate to say, even sometimes some preachers I've listened to, who have been trying to explain salvation, and I wasn't even clear what they were saying, and I know what he's trying to say. And there's a way you can so speak. Acts 14, the Bible says, Paul and Barnabas went into the synagogue and they so spake that a multitude believed. You know, there's a way you can speak that make it simple and clear for people to understand the gospel and be saved. And then there's a way you can so present it that nobody knows what in the world you're talking about. One of the things that's very difficult for someone, and again, if someone led you to Christ, so you got saved when you were older, you understand. That's why we use the Roman road. Most of the verses are all in Romans, because you just simply go through the same book. You know what happens when you go to Genesis, and then you go to Revelation, then you go to Romans, and you go to John, and then you go to Galatians, and then you go over, and they're thinking, are you just picking and choosing verses out of here and making them say whatever you want? You see what I mean? There's no continuity to it. And you want to just make it as simple and as concise as you can. And Romans lays it out very, very well. And it's easy to tell people, hey, Genesis tells us how everything began. Revelation tells us how everything ended up. The book in the Bible that tells us simply how to know we're going to heaven is the book of Romans. And you're prepared. You're ready to give the gospel. Are you prepared? Do you have the preparation of the gospel of peace? When I have the New Testament. The New Testament I carry for soul winning, it has these ribbons in it, like your Bible may have ribbon on it. New Testament has a ribbon in it. That ribbon is in Romans chapter 3. I don't use that New Testament for anything else. It's just for witnessing, just for soul winning. And that ribbon is in Romans chapter 3. Why? Because when they want to know they're going to heaven, I take that out and I pull on that ribbon, and where's the Bible open to? Romans chapter 3. Okay? And I'm ready to start with Romans 3 and verse number 23. There's two things that does, because when that opportunity arises, you may get a little nervous. And if that ribbon's not there, you'll open your Bible and you'll just believe they took Romans out of the New Testament. You'll be looking all over and you swear it's not there. And so, and by the way, let me ask you this. If I said, okay, I want to tell you how you know you're going to heaven, you say, yeah, I'd like to see that. And I say, okay, the Bible says here, you know what's going through your head? They weren't ready to do this. They're not prepared to talk to me. And boy, I tell you what, you just give the enemy an inch, and he'll take it. And all of a sudden, they'll think of something else they'd rather do, or something else they got to get done, or some interruption, and boy, he'll drive a truck through there. But when you say, I want to show you from the Bible how you can know for sure when you die, you go to heaven, the first thing is right here. They'll say, wow, they must be ready to do this. Okay? Preparation of the gospel of peace. You ought to be prepared and know how to give the gospel. So we have, now the first word was feet. The second word is preparation. The third word, back again in Ephesians chapter 6, the third word I want you to look at is gospel. Your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Now, the gospel is found in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 3. 1 Corinthians 15 and verses 1 through 3. The Bible says this. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, and which ye also have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep memory what I preached unto you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which also I received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. That's the gospel. What's the gospel? The death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's the gospel. And that's what we're going to tell people. R.A. Torrey, who succeeded D.L. Moody in ministry at the Moody Church, and he said there's three things every Christian ought to be able to do with their Bible. They ought to be able to, number one, show men that they are lost. Number two, they ought to be able to show men that they are in need of a Savior. And number three, they ought to be able to show them that Jesus Christ is the Savior they need. Every Christian ought to be able to do that with their Bible. That's the gospel. It is about the gospel. Can I help you? It's not about opinions. It's not about arguing. Never seen anybody come to Christ where the one witnessing was doing this. Okay? Doesn't work. It's not about arguing. It's not about, hey, it's not about standards. I can't tell you the number of homes that I've been into where somebody's smoking a cigarette and they say, do you mind if I smoke? And you know what? I don't say, bless God, put that cancer stick out. Huh? I just say, it's your house. I'm a guest in their home. They can do whatever they want to do. I just want to give them the gospel. You say, oh, I smell like smoke when I leave the house. Yeah, but if they trusted Christ their Savior, that's worth it. Those clothes will wash. My hair will wash out. It's washing away. That's the problem. You didn't have to laugh. But, yeah. You know, you don't. That's not the issue. I had one lady one time was going to give her the gospel, and she goes, no, wait a minute. Are you one of those dancing Baptists? I didn't know there were dancing Baptists. Some of you didn't either. You're going to go look it up, aren't you? But and you know what? You know what you say? When any of those things come up, you know what you say? Hey, I'll be happy to talk to you about that as soon as I'm done sharing with you what I want to share with you. And you know what happens? When you get done and they receive Christ their Savior and they get eternal life, they don't care whether you're a dancing Baptist or not. That's not important anymore. And so I'm not there. Jesus didn't say go into all the world and preach your convictions. He said, go into all the world and preach the gospel. I want to get the gospel to them. All right? Let the Lord, hey, the Lord will straighten all that other stuff out. You just get them to Jesus. You don't get better to get saved. You get saved to get better. And you just let the Lord do the price. Do the work there in their life. It's about the gospel. What is it? Listen, all have sinned. There's a price to pay for sin. Death and hell, separation from God. Jesus paid that price for you when he died on the cross. And you must, by faith, trust him as your Savior. He'll forgive your sin. He'll give you the gift of eternal life. You shall be saved. And you just give, stay on the ground. And by the way, that's the full gospel. Anybody say, you're a full gospel church? Yes. Yes, we are. We're full gospel as the Bible says it's full. Amen? And so you got to be able to give the gospel. I love the song that says, suffer a sinner whose heart overflows, loving his Savior to tell what he knows. Once more to tell it, would I embrace? I'm only a sinner saved by grace. That's all it is. Hey, suffer a sinner whose heart overflows. What? Loving his Savior to tell what he knows. Once more to tell it, would I embrace? I loved it. Just, I'm only a sinner saved by grace. Telling someone else how they can get their sins forgiven. That's the gospel. The gospel of Christ. Okay, we had three words so far. We had eat, we have preparation, and we have gospel. And then the last word is peace. Peace. It's the gospel of peace. Therefore, being justified by faith, Romans 5:1, we have peace with God. Peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace with God about your past. Peace with God about your present. Peace with God about your future with him. You have peace. Peace with God about yourself. Peace with God with your family. Peace with God when it comes to the Word of God. Peace with the Church of God. Hey, all those things change when you come to Jesus Christ. So in Mark chapter 5, when the maniac of Gadara got saved, I mean, he was a wild man. Running about and cutting himself. He lived in the cemetery. And people tried to help him. Some they say, you know, they came and bound him with fetters and with chains. They were trying to keep him from hurting himself. And what did he do? He broke them like they were nothing. Screaming. Yelling in tombs. Imagine you're sitting at night and you're just, ah! What's that? Oh, that's that maniac out there. Huh? They were afraid of him. They were kind of glad he was out there. Then they heard one day when Jesus came, and they didn't hear about him first. They heard about that, well, they heard Jesus did something, and all the swine ran off the cliff and into the sea, and they all drowned, 2,000 of them. People said, man, I got to go out and see this. Now, I don't know whether they came out to see Jesus or came out to see 2,000 dead pigs. I don't know. But there was going to be a sight and a spectacle, so they wanted to come see it. But they didn't expect to see what they saw. The Bible says they came out and they saw this maniac, this wild man, and guess what? He's sitting, He's clothed and in his right mind talking to Jesus. You know what sitting, clothed, and in his right mind all mean? Peace. Peace. Something he hadn't had for years. Just to be calm. I mean, now don't raise your hand, but how many of you think of somebody right now, and maybe it was yourself before you came to know Christ? You couldn't even sit still. There are people who have a hard time being still. There's people who have a hard time with this. Listen. There are people who have a hard time with that right there. Say, what was that? Silence. You know people? Always got to have something on. Radio's got to be on. Music has to be on. Television has to be on. Something in my ear. Something got to be going on all the time. I don't just want silence. Because the Bible says this. Be still and know that I am God. If man is still and man is quiet, guess what? Your thoughts will go upward. Your thoughts will go to God. God says, I want to give you peace. Peace. The world cries for peace tonight. They'll never know peace till the Prince of Peace comes. He's the one who will bring peace. He's the only one that can bring peace. Are your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace? Starts with your feet. Go, yeah, got to be willing to go. But you have to be willing to be prepared to go. You gotta prepare yourself and be ready to give the gospel. God will use you. God will give you opportunities when He sees you're prepared to take them. He'll give you those opportunities. And then you give the gospel. The death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That Christ died for you. He was buried and He rose again. And listen, He's able to save all those that come unto God by Him. He's a living Savior. If you'll trust Him as your Savior, oh, the peace of God that comes to your heart. Oftentimes when I have opportunity to lead someone to Christ, I often ask the Lord that, I remember when I prayed and asked Christ to be my Savior. I was in the second row in on this side of the church. And it was just like this. It was two sections, and I was right there at that second row, knelt down. The evangelist was in the third row, or the third seat. And I remember asking the Lord to be my Savior. I got up, and I walked back that aisle. And it was like I wasn't even hitting the floor. I just felt so light. I hadn't felt light in years, but I felt light that night. Huh? You know, and I knew, just, and I'm 6 years old. But I felt a burden lifted off. What was that? The peace of God. The sin was gone. And the peace of God took its place. I oftentimes ask God, would, if they meant business with you, if this person really was sincere and asked Christ to save them, would you give them the peace in their heart that you gave me that night? Where they'll know God did something in their heart tonight. It's peace with God. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God. There's so many people wanting peace. We have the answer. It's Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, the gospel. You know, it's difficult to stand. The soldier here talks about standing and withstanding and stand firm and stand strong and withstand. You know, it's hard to do that if you don't have shoes on. A lot more difficult to take your stand if you're barefoot. And I'm pretty sure, I'm pretty sure the gospel of preparation of peace isn't flip-flops, okay? Just so you know. But you put a good pair, when you're in the army, when you're in one of the services, you know what's important? The shoes they give you. Those are important. And they give you the firm footing. Are your feet shod tonight? Let me look at your feet. Are your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace? Father, I pray that You'll help us to put on the whole armor of God, and that would include our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Lord, I pray that we would be an army at this church that would go forth from this place with our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, that we will always be ready to give an answer to every man who asketh us a reason of the hope that lies within us. The Lord, when you have someone whose heart is ready to receive the gospel, Lord, you'll be able to tap any one of us on the shoulder because we are ready. We are prepared. We're willing to go and give the gospel. There's people we meet every day, everywhere we go. I pray, God, that we'd be giving the gospel out. That we would not sow sparingly, but we would sow bountifully. And then you would allow us to reap bountifully. God, help us put the main thing and keep the main thing the main thing. The main thing is getting the gospel to a lost and dying world. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'll finish the prayer here in just a moment, but right now, tonight, just between you and God, I wonder how many believers tonight would say, Pastor, I need my feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. I'm talking to people tonight who used to witness regularly, and you stopped doing it. Wanting to win others to Christ, wanting to give others to gospel was a real priority to you, and it hasn't been much lately. Your feet stopped going. I wonder tonight, you say, Preacher, the Spirit of God stopped at my seat. And I'm asking Him tonight that my feet be shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. It'll use me to give the gospel to people this week. Here's my hand, Pastor. Pray for me tonight. Would you slip it up, Christian? Amen. 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 You may put them down. Hands across the room tonight. We spoke tonight in our 5:30 Christian growth class. If you lined up all the unsaved people in this world, they'd circle the globe. I believe it was 30 times. The line would grow 20 miles every day. Every day in the world, there's 345,000 babies born who will never hear the name of Jesus. Shame on us. It's time to shod our feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Let's tell every creature about Jesus. Father, thank you for speaking to hearts tonight. And Lord, I pray tonight that you'll hear the prayer that people will make around these altars. That Lord, we'll walk back to our seats and we'll look down and we'll see that our feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Lord, you'll help us. You'll enable these who have a heart to witness to learn from their Bible how they can show men they're lost and show men their need of a Savior and that Jesus is a Savior they need. Lord, if there's some here tonight who've been saved but never been baptized, I pray they'd come and say, I need to be obedient and be baptized tonight. If there's some who are saved and scripturally baptized, and they believe this is where they ought to belong, then I pray they'd come and say, Preacher, we want to belong here and serve the Lord here. Whatever it is that you've dealt with their heart about, God, I pray they'd respond to you this evening. Have your way in every heart, please, and I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, the pianist is going to play. As she plays, Brother Bob will sing. God has spoken to your heart tonight. Respond to him.
I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus?
That's right.
Who died upon that cruel tree? To think of his great sacrifice at Calvary, I know my Lord expects the best from me. How many are the lost that I have lifted? How many are the chained I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when He has done so much for me?
The hours that I have wasted are so many. The hours I've spent for Christ so few. Because of all my lack of love for Jesus, I wonder if his heart is breaking too. How many are the laws that I have lifted? How many are the chains I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when he has done so much for me? I wonder, have I cared enough for others, or have I let them die alone? I might have helped a wonder to the Savior, the seed of precious life I might have sown. How many are the laws that I have lifted? How many are the chains I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when he has done so much for me? No longer will I stay within the valley. I'll climb to mountain heights above. The world is dying now for want of someone to tell them of the Savior's matchless love. How many are the lost that I have lifted? How many are the saved I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when he has done so much for me?
Now for this evening, we thank you, Lord, for speaking to our hearts. Thank you, Lord, for even young hearts that are tender to you speaking to them. And Lord, I pray that you'll dismiss us now with your care. Lord, help us to go and be equipped and be ready. Thank you, Lord, you give us all we need to do battle with the enemy this week. And we are more than conquerors through him who loved us so. Remind us that greater is he that's in us than he that is in the world. And Lord, help us to go out to do battle this week and to know that we're on the winning side. We love you. I pray that we'll see folks come to know Christ as their Savior this week as a result of us having our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. Well, don't forget the people helping with the float. You'd like to help on that, and we need help with that. If you want to jump in on that meeting down there, Brother Bob will meet you in the conference room. That'll be very, very important. for that day. And let's see, I think I meet with Villatoro's. I have to have a meeting with you. And don't forget, tomorrow night, ladies, sign up for the bowling, would you? Have a great time tomorrow night. And then Grove City School of the Bible Tuesday night. And all of us back here Wednesday night for the midweek service, okay? Busy times and a great time to be alive to serve the Lord. Amen? All right, let's sing It's a Grand Thing to Be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's hear you sing. Hey, it's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in His army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you. You are dismissed.